Hi, I'm James.
And I'm Anthony.
And this is Words and Numbers. What's new and exciting in your world this week?
One of our listeners, a friend of mine, Russ, wrote this week asking about the IRS.
Wait a second. Go ahead and tell everybody the truth.
Well, Russ is actually James' father.
There you go.
Russ and I exchange emails from time to time, much to James' annoyance.
They're always about me in one way or another, and I feel like I'm being cut out of the discussion.
Russ wrote asking about the IRS and the Inflation Recovery Act. Let me start off by saying the Inflation Recovery Act doesn't actually do anything to fight inflation. The title is simply marketing.
It's going to make inflation worse.
Yeah, if anything, it's going to make inflation worse. One of the things it does do, however, is to beef up the IRS. The law calls for an increase in the IRS budget by $80 billion over the course of the next decade. Now, put that in perspective, the IRS's annual budget right now is $13 billion. This is an $8 billion increase on a $13 billion budget. This is a tremendous increase. For all the problems that American taxpayers have with the IRS, everything from calling and not getting an answer to asking a question and getting the wrong answer.
It's 50-50.
Is it really 50-50?
I read a couple of guys who did some research here. It's a coin flip.
Astounding.
And when it's a coin flip, you shouldn't bother calling.
More than that, if they give you the wrong answer, this is just too bad. You follow their incorrect advice and you're still liable for the taxes. Now, for all of the horrible service that taxpayers get, you would think that we would be happy about the IRS getting $80 billion because it's going to mean better taxpayer services. And it turns out of that $80 billion, only three go to improving taxpayer services. $46 billion go toward enforcement. Now, politicians like to talk about closing loopholes, and enforcement brings this to mind, but the Inflation Recovery Act, in addition to giving the IRS this $46 billion that it's going to use toward enforcement, contains $370 billion worth of new loopholes in the form of subsidies and corporate welfare.
There you go.
Well, what's astounding here is each new loophole creates a new lobbying interest that becomes a new constituent to contribute to politicians' campaigns.
Yep, you've diagnosed this perfectly.
As much as politicians like to get us all frothed up about loopholes and they promise to close them, the loopholes are actually quite beneficial to the politicians because each one enables them to hide what they're doing.
That's right. And everybody should remember this before they start whining about people not paying their fair share. These are built right into the tax code. They're a feature, not a bug. You're crazy if you don't take the deductions you're allowed to take.
But more than that, the politicians deliberately designed these loopholes to encourage us to behave in ways the politicians want us to behave. This is the way the whole $80 billion was framed for the public, that this is going to increase the IRS's budget and they can now take down all these billionaires that aren't paying their taxes. Enter Congress Joint Committee on Taxation. The Joint Committee on Taxation is a nonpartisan group that performs analysis for Congress on things like this. They estimate that this $80 billion budget boost will enable the IRS to collect an additional $200 billion in taxes. And that sounds pretty good. At a cost of $80 billion, the IRS is going to bring in $200 billion more. Except here's the fine print. The Joint Committee on Taxation also estimates that up to 90% of that $200 billion in new taxes will come from small businesses making less than $200,000 annually. You and I have talked about this many times before, and we gave this warning, and here it is from the Joint Committee on Taxation. If 90% of these new taxes the IRS is going to be bringing in are going to come from people and businesses making less than $200,000 annually, that means that the IRS is targeting gig workers. It's targeting the guy who makes an extra $10,000, $20,000 on the side by driving Uber, or the couple who have a beach house and they rent it out to make some extra money through Airbnb, the IRS is coming after them.
And when we use those words, coming after, that's really what's going to happen here. These new agents have entered a target-rich environment. If you're making $80,000, $90,000, $100,000 a year and you say to yourself, well, I'm finally doing well, that's a lot of money that I make, you just became very interesting to the IRS.
Yeah, and more than that, compare the guy who makes $10,000, $20,000 on the side through driving Uber, compare him to Jeff Bezos. Now, Jeff Bezos hires legions of accountants and lawyers to make sure that his taxes are done correctly, and if the IRS comes after him, those legions of accountants and lawyers will defend him. The guy who's driving Uber, he may not even have filed paperwork, so he's going to have a big problem.
These new and exciting moves that they're making are going to make what we would call regular middle-class people very, very upset.
One last thing. People are claiming the IRS will use this money to hire an additional 87,000 agents. I'm not saying it's wrong, but it's not necessarily correct either. Here's why. Last year, the Treasury Department did propose a plan to hire that many new employees over the next decade if it got the money to do so. And now, of course, it's getting the money to do so. But not all of those employees would be agents. Many of them would be replacing current employees. And there's nothing in the Inflation Reduction Act that actually requires the IRS to hire anyone. Further, the number of IRS employees who work in enforcement specifically has dropped 30% since 2010, while today half are eligible for retirement. So this $80 billion, even spread over 10 years, if it does result in an increase in the number of IRS hires, it's not entirely clear that it will be a net increase over and above the number that are going to be retiring anyway.
I think, you know, the 2010 business, that's when the IRS had fallen out of favor with Congress, right?
That's right. It did.
Everybody is bending over backwards to try and make these people behave like human beings. And it worked for a while, but I mean, you know what's going to happen. It's going to work for a while. They're going to keep everything really quiet. And then over time, it's just going to come back to what it was. Because when you give a bunch of people the authority to dip into other people's lives, it just gets progressively worse.
I want to repeat something that we say often. The middle classes in the United States earn twice as much as the top 1%, and they're taxed at half the rate. Politicians know that the middle class is a great untapped tax resource, and they're going to come after us. This, I think, is the first salvo.
You simply can't get enough by taxing the billionaires.
That's right.
We've got an out-of-control government with a colossal budget. We all know that they're not going to be able to pay for a good number of the things that they're doing. This is going to become a very ugly addition to the federal government. So I want to go from talking about decent people to talking about CNN. There's a new boss over there, a guy named Chris Licht. It might be liked. He is now warning anxious staffers. What the hell is an anxious staffer? Over more changes after they have just fired the guy who ran Reliable Sources and Brian Stelter. And you might remember that not too terribly long ago, there were a number of stories that emerged. Well, not exactly stories, but pronouncements that CNN was going to become a serious news outlet again.
Right.
Which is a lovely admission that it no longer was. How do you take a ship that big and get it turned around? My knee-jerk reaction is that axing Reliable Sources is not the correct way. That's something that maybe should have stuck around. But the interesting question is always, what remains? Don Lemon, who is one of the worst partisan hacks I have ever seen, if I were to take over CNN tomorrow, he wouldn't survive the first day. He has been told that he's not going anywhere. So on the one hand, we are told that CNN is going to become a respectable news outlet again. And on the other, they're not getting rid of the chief offender. I remember when CNN first appeared with that big, heavy box that you would have to take from chair to chair with the wire that ran all the way to your TV. And I remember tuning into CNN thinking, wow, I can finally get things in real time from a bunch of people who seem like they're very committed to delivering the news.
Yeah, and get it any time of the day.
It was astonishing. And when I later went on to study politics, it was a godsend. I really needed that sort of thing. They went from that to something that is so far away from that. If you're going to have real news and you still have Don Lemon on your schedule, you've done it wrong. Because of this, I can't find a single news outlet that I trust across the board. I mean, maybe somebody will email and tell me what I should be looking at. And I've got a number of things that I use in qualified ways. If I want international news, I go straight to the Christian Science Monitor. If I want to hear about the Arab world, I go to Al Jazeera. These are not perfect answers, but they're the best answers I've got. And that's not the foolishness of the week. For the foolishness of the weekend, I want you to imagine Finland. Have you ever been to Finland?
No, never have.
They're having a little bit of a bowel movement over what their prime minister has done. The prime minister of Finland is a 36-year-old woman. I don't know anything about her politics. I don't know if she's a particularly good prime minister or not. None of that matters. What does matter, and her name is Sanna Marin, and I'm sure I botched that pronunciation too, there was a party that she attended with what looked like, for all the world, her friends. It looked like everybody in the video that appeared later. It seemed that they all knew each other, and it was just a nice night out for them. And it's clear that she had been at least drinking. A 36-year-old woman drinks, film at 11. And then there was all the dancing. As a man who has never danced in his entire life, never not once, I don't know what to say about this. But should a prime minister be allowed doesn't seem the right word. It's something like allowed. Should shame fall on her because she spent a night out with her friends drinking and dancing? The answer from Finland seems to be yes.
Really?
The answer I would give would be no every time.
I'm surprised. I thought the Finns were more liberal in their outlook on such things.
And I'm sure they are. But everybody's got a political enemy. And somebody made these videos public. Why can't a prime minister live her life? I just know a bunch of people are acting to make her life miserable. I don't defend politicians very often, but should a 36-year-old prime minister be allowed to go live her life and have a nice night out with her friends? The answer for me is going to be yes.
We give away mugs from time to time to our listeners on Backstage and on Patreon. We've never done it on an actual episode, so let's do it this time. We have these nice Words and Numbers mugs. We'll send it to the first person who sends us an email with the subject line mug. Send the email to wordsandnumberspodcast@gmail.com. To get more Ant and James, buy a copy of our excellent book, Cooperation and Coercion. You can find the paper and electronic versions on Amazon and the audio version on Audible. If you'd like to support Words and Numbers, make your way over to patreon.com/wordsandnumbers, where you can contribute to our podcast-making habits. If you'd like to schedule us to come speak at your event, be it corporate or educational, or have James officiate at your wedding, send us an email at wordsandnumberspodcast@gmail.com.
Do you remember when political correctness was all the rage?
This would have been like late 80s, early 90s.
Yeah, early 90s. I remember being at UConn during those years. For the most part, I really enjoyed my time at the University of Connecticut. I thought it was just great. Would have been a lot better if I wasn't working 60 hours a week, third shift, but we all pay for our sins in different ways. I was a little older, 3 years, 4 years older than the normal undergraduate. And those years made a critical difference in what I was willing to engage professors on.
Mm-hmm.
I wasn't of a mind to just roll over and mark as correct everything that fell out of a professor's mouth. And I would occasionally pick on them, and they would occasionally pick back. I remember a red sociologist, out of the closet red sociologist, who would refer to me very typically as Mr. Reagan in the front row. And then, of course, peals of laughter would erupt in the lecture hall, and I was supposed to sit there feeling embarrassed. And then a strange thing happened. They came up with a rule at the University of Connecticut, a rule against what they called laughism.
Putting someone on the spot so other people laugh at them.
That's correct.
Yeah.
When I would bring that up with the sociologist, he would say, well, that rule isn't for you.
Yeah.
It's for other people. You started to realize that political correctness was a strange animal. The people who pushed it called it political correctness. And then the people who worked against it called it political correctness.
Mm-hmm.
So it was both a happy and a sad term, depending on which side of the debate you found yourself. And I submit that we've got the same thing going on now, but But I'm going to get to that in just a minute or two, because there's an intervening period, I think, that's every bit as interesting. And it surrounds what we would probably call green politics, where you're not allowed to have some other opinion. And then this trickled into markets. And all of those corporations the environmentalists were calling evil 10 minutes before were now getting on board with green initiatives. And everywhere I look, I see all kinds of green initiatives. And I ask myself, do the people running those corporations really value those things? Or are they doing what they're doing in order to placate a bunch of very loud people so they can make a bigger profit?
I imagine there's a tremendous amount of the latter.
Yeah, it's the second.
Look, companies give us what we want. And if what we want is greenism, that's what they're going to deliver. I've got an interesting story about greenism that just occurred in my own kitchen. We have a refrigerator that's 15 years old. One of these ones has the water and the ice in the door type thing. And it starts acting up. The guy comes out and looks at it and he says, yeah, there's something blown here in, he says, one of, right, the computers. I mean, how many computers are in a refrigerator? Apparently there's more than one. He says, one of these computers has blown, and he said, I can replace this one device here, and it might work, it might not. If it doesn't, I'm going to have to go replace the others, and if that happens, you've spent more money than what it would cost you to buy a new refrigerator. And I looked at him, I said, this is astounding. Why is this costing me so much? And he said, hey, you got a good run with this refrigerator. It lasted 15 years. I said, what do you mean a good run?
No, that's right.
Yeah, he says 6 to 10 years is the usual. And I said, hang on, buddy. I've got a refrigerator out in my garage that I bought in 1990, and it's still running perfectly fine. He said, yeah, the problem is with all of the green rules that exist, the refrigerators have to be energy efficient and da-da-da, and that requires computers to monitor them. And because of that, they simply don't last as long. Now, stop and think about this for a minute. What kind of green initiative is this to say that you've got to design your refrigerator to be, I don't know, pick a number, let's say 20% more efficient, but in doing so, the thing lasts for one third as long as it would have. Now we got to build three refrigerators where before we only built one.
And let's ask the follow-up question. How do we feel about landfills filled to the top with broken refrigerators?
Refrigerators, right, exactly.
So whatever the green initiative was, it's not working.
Well, yeah.
But it looks like it works in years 1 through 6.
That's the thing. You look at the short term, everything looks great.
That's right.
But look at the long term, and you're actually making the environment worse. That tells me the people are acting for the purpose of appearance. If they really cared about the thing, they'd be thinking long term.
Well, hang on here, because I think that criticism is easily leveled at, in this example, the people who produce the refrigerators, the people who sell the refrigerators. I think they're going to throw up their hands and say, well, this other group of people thinks they want this, and they think it so hard that they're not going to buy any other kind of refrigerator we make. So hooray for green politics. Let's make our refrigerators. I don't exactly blame them. I blame the reflexively stupid people on the other side of the coin who can only see data point one in an argument that probably goes to 15 or 20.
Yeah, but you see, I think we've been trained to only look at data point one, because you said a moment ago that you're not allowed to disagree with environmental right. pronouncements. I think it's worse than that. You're not even allowed to question them. Not saying I disagree, I just say, okay, where'd you get these numbers? How do I know this is true? And so consequently, we've been trained not to question when we're told something like, this refrigerator is better for the environment.
Yeah, no, and I remember one of my children, not going to point out which one, but having done some time in scouting, looked at me and said, why do you hate the earth?
Why do you hate the right?
What the is that all about?
Right.
You know who hates the earth? No one. It's this kind of nonsense that gets driven into people. And my kids were homeschooled, right? They picked this up somewhere else. Imagine if they had been subject to state power in the government school system. God only knows how bad that would have been.
But you say they're homeschooled. Let me give you what I'm observing from people schooled in the public school system, and I include my own children here. They've come to believe as young adults that the planet's not going to be around another generation from now.
Sure.
And consequently, they've got this horribly depressing outlook on the future. And again, they're taught not to ask, because you ask for evidence, you must be on the other side.
And that kind of gets us to where we were lumbering, and that's wokeism. Like political correctness, woke as a term was coined and used by the people who began this movement. And then the people who stand astride that movement also decided to use that term, only to them it's insulting. So we've got the woke and the woke, depending on how you care to look right. at this. I think it also plays out in the news, and you start seeing how various minorities have been treated in various communities. I'm thinking especially about blacks who have been killed by police officers across the country. Everything that comes next is not about that. Mm-hmm. I want to talk about entertainment, which colors our interpretations of many, many things on such a subliminal level. I'm thinking specifically of movies and television. When we think about pop culture and how that informs our day-to-day life, we're almost always talking about movies and television. Chris Pratt made a lot of money and a lot of fame on the TV show Parks and Rec, where he played kind of a doughy doofus. Then he got really ripped and found his way into the Marvel Universe. Right. And then found his way to executive producer status over at Amazon. And he made a terrible movie called The Tomorrow War. And then he made this TV series as executive producer of the series, The Terminal List. I saw this Rotten Tomatoes thing that 30% of the critics, maybe even less, gave it any credit at all, whereas 95% of the audience did. And I thought, okay, something is amiss here. Audiences and critics never fully agree. When the critics all said Schindler's List might be the best movie ever, people watched it and said, yeah, I don't want to talk about that anymore. Mm-hmm. And I think that's a perfectly reasonable thing for both groups to be saying. The people whose job it is to tell us what is good and what is not, well, they're going to have a different take on what we, the consumers of that product, think. But it's never that far apart. There's a bit of a delta between the two groups, but it's only a bit of one. If the critics think that something is unbelievably good, so's everybody else, on balance. And yet, with The Terminal List, not even close. And I thought to myself, well, maybe I should watch this Terminal List and see what the hell's going on. And I did. And I'm with the audience on this one. Was it great? No. But it was very, very good. I sat there in rapt attention watching it. And what made it good? It's a story about a guy who's with his platoon, and they get set up and they all die except for two of them. They get back to the U.S. One of the two dies, and Chris Pratt looks at the evidence and said, that's not a suicide. That's a murder. And everybody's telling him he's crazy. Well, turns out he's not crazy, and it was. And before you know it, Chris Pratt's wife and his daughter are killed as well. And this sends him off on a one-man wrecking crew of a series where he unpacks everybody who had anything to do with it. It is incredibly satisfying. There's something about watching a vengeance story that really hits home. This has been an element of our entertainment for a very long time. So what's the problem? Why do all the critics hate it so much? It's not exactly pro-military, but it's not anti-military either. It presents that universe the way that most people would seem to think that universe exists. It's not anti-violence. And apparently, any movie that's made now that doesn't discourage violence in all of its forms is a problem. Well, I don't think it is. I like watching movies, and this kind is way more interesting to me than the men who sip their coffee at the corner coffee shop debating things for whatever passes as friends. I don't find any of that amusing in any way. If I want to see that, I'll go down to the coffee shop on the corner.
Right, experience it firsthand.
That's right. I want to see something fantastic. Mm-hmm. And it occurred to me that a lot of the movies that have been made since we've been back in theaters, remember, we didn't go to movie theaters for, what, 2 years?
Right.
And we would find things streaming on HBO Max or whatever. Somehow it's not the same experience. When we finally got to go back to the movies, a bunch of turkeys got released, movies that I would go see and think, how many people had a green light this before it made its way into my wallet?
Right.
And then there was Top Gun, the sequel.
Did you like it?
Loved it.
Really?
And here's the weird part. I never even watched the first one.
Oh, the first one's superb.
I never even saw it. It didn't matter to me all that much. I guess I'm a fan of Tom Cruise, looking at the movies that I like. but I don't have a knee-jerk reflexive love for everything he does. I think he's kind of a strange guy, and I don't know that I would want to hang out with him, but his movies are entertaining. If you think about the second one, you're not even allowed to know who the enemy was.
Right.
No group or country was ever mentioned. They were just flying missions against, quote, the enemy.
Right.
You know why? Well, because wherever they would pick, then that movie wouldn't sell there. If you say the Iranians aren't going to let that movie into their theaters.
Right.
Good business decision, kind of like the Walmart Green Initiative, when right. it comes right down yeah. to it. Right? Yeah. And why was that movie so successful when it didn't adopt any of the woke tropes that we're being told we must experience? I think the short answer is that regular people don't really think that.
Mm-hmm.
Regular people enjoy a good story.
They go out for entertainment, not to be preached at.
And it doesn't matter whether the characters in that story happen to be this race or that, this gender or that. What matters is that the story is outstanding. I routinely watch movies in which there are no white characters. The same way I routinely watch movies in which there are no black characters. Now, almost every movie is going to be somewhere in the middle of those two extremes. But neither of them matters to me very much when I think about the story. Now, maybe certain groups have been very underrepresented over time. I think that's a reason to try to tell different stories. It's not a reason to shoehorn people into pre-existing ones.
It's interesting you say that, because I was watching a Jane Austen film just recently. This one was made just a couple of years ago, maybe even last year. And the setting is 19th century England. The actual setting, historically, we're all white people. And the director cast people of color. And at first it's jarring that I'm thinking, okay, this is great. Why should you be concerned about a black actress playing a role of a white person or vice versa if none of that is relevant to the storyline, which it isn't. Until, as the movie went on, I found myself getting more and more annoyed. And I realized why. It was because the number of people of color that were cast in the film were out of proportion of the number of people of color who exist in the general population. Not to say that I have a problem with that one way or the other, but what it did do is it screamed to me that we're doing this for appearance sake.
That's right.
Rather than simply saying, okay, we're going to be colorblind in choosing our actors, actresses, choose whoever's best. No, this was going to the extreme of we're deliberately going to show you how woke we're being.
Last night, I watched that last Daniel Craig James Bond flick, No Time to Die.
Oh, good film.
Which I thought was just spot on perfect.
You know, Queen Elizabeth played herself in that film.
Queen Elizabeth as herself.
They wanted to film one of the scenes in Buckingham Palace, and she gave her permission on condition that she got to play herself.
That's fantastic.
Isn't that great?
Anyway, the thing I wanted to talk about was the character of Moneypenny. Which,
oh yeah,
for those who are aficionados of the James Bond universe, Moneypenny was always, and I mean always, a middle-aged, over-the-hill, attractive, smart woman.
Mm-hmm.
And she was sweet on James Bond.
And very clearly never had a chance with him, but he was sweet back to her.
Yeah, that's right. Let's just say she wasn't his type.
Yeah.
The Moneypenny in the Daniel Craig universe is a young black woman. I never gave it a second thought. That seemed just fine. The way that Judy Dench's character of M was always an old man. Judy Dench was fantastic as M.
Oh, she was. She was superb.
And you see, these are not questions that get to the center of the James Bond universe. These are supporting roles, and when you choose who plays them, now you have interesting possibilities with the story as it unfolds.
Yeah, and I'll give you a couple others. You know the actor Peter Dinklage, he's short.
He's not short, he's a little person.
Peter Dinklage, who's...
not the tallest man in the world.
Particularly short, yeah. Appeared in a couple of films I've seen recently. One of them, I Think We're Alone Now. The movie begins and everybody's gone. It's just him in this town. There's nobody. And as the story unfolds, you come to find out why. But the story goes on, and he's interacting with various characters and so forth, and nobody makes any mention of the fact that he's short. It's not part of the storyline, but it all works perfectly fine.
The way regular life works.
The way regular life works. Yeah, exactly.
I'm really okay with casting calls. I think that there's an art to it. I'm not a filmmaker. I see people who are laboring intensely over who to cast for what. And I think that's really, really interesting. What I can't stand is that the woke crowd demand that everything conform to their preferred worldview. That's not how regular life works. And art, even pop culture, is a reflection of regular life. What happens when we try to hammer a round peg into a square hole? You end up with the DC universe. Mm-hmm. Name me one single movie in that epic run of movies that's worth watching. There isn't one, because they're way more concerned with making male characters female and making white characters black and so on. What worked well from DC? Those three Batman movies from a bunch of years ago, in which Morgan Freeman played a character that's almost always a white guy, but all of a sudden he's a black guy, and he played the hell out of it.
Yeah.
Right? And those movies were great because you never got the sense that anybody was being pandered to.
Right. In that case, Morgan Freeman, and in my case, Peter Dinklage, those two are fabulous actors.
Oh, God, yes. As I narrate my own life, I hear Morgan Freeman narrate.
Right, exactly.
Because he's just that iconic. When I say don't think about Morgan Freeman's voice, everything you hear is Morgan Freeman's voice. I think it's great, but look at where we've come. We've come full circle. We're back to political correctness, which was stupid in the first instance. People are pretty decent. When you begin with the assumption that everybody's terrible, and unless you can shame everybody, nobody will ever do the right thing, I'm sorry, I'm checking out of that argument.
I want to say something in defense of wokeism, or at least its roots. You and I have noticed as we go to high schools across the country, and you've remarked on it a number of times, how kind students are to each other.
Yeah, that's right.
How kind, how accepting, and I see this, and it persists up through college. In terms of getting along with one another and accepting one another's differences, they're a breed apart from where you and I were at that age.
That is exactly right.
That's a huge improvement to society. Now, some of it has to be due to that initial wokeism, or what you referred to as political correctness back in the 80s, 90s. Maybe it's the case that the whole political correctness slash wokeism movement is suffering from mission creep. That is, they achieved what they were out to achieve, which is we're now becoming much more tolerant and accepting of each other, and so they're looking for something else.
And that is generally what happens. I've got two great examples. The March of Dimes, which existed to find a cure for polio.
Right.
Not only did we find a cure, we found two cures, one by Salk and one by Sabin. I've written an article on this with my historian wife just recently, so it's fresh in the mind. The second is the Mothers Against Drunk Driving, who campaigned for a uniform nationwide standard for drunk driving, which they achieved. But each of these two groups just redefined its mission and did so in rather pronounced ways.
I think there's something to be said for redefining your mission. Once you've attained your goal, find another goal that's in the same space and go after that. So Mothers Against Drunk Driving does the 0.08 blood alcohol thing, and they achieve that. Now they go after something else, drug use or what have you. That's in the same universe, and it's another problem. But we have achieved great strides in breaking down barriers between people. And what's happened is, rather than finding some other place in which real barriers exist and fighting that, the wokeist culture is finding barriers where they don't exist and scolding the rest of us for them.
I remember the first few times I walked into rooms filled with a lot of people, and I was the only white guy in the room. I remember how profoundly out of step I felt.
Right.
I remember thinking, I don't belong here. They don't want me here. And then I sat back and thought, okay, my black friends have been experiencing this their whole lives.
Mm-hmm.
This is exactly what they have experienced, except the racism from the whites to the blacks when we were younger was much more pronounced than it was from the blacks to the whites. So not only did my friends feel that out of step, they felt that out of step almost all the time, and they felt that out of step as they were confronting hard racism. And I remember my black friends saying, don't worry about it, you're cool here.
Hmm.
And it turned out I was. And isn't that something?
And what a difference that makes for them to say that.
It did. It was a weight off my shoulders.
Yeah.
And we've come, I think, around enough as a people. And yet, are we where we want to be? And yeah, probably not. That's an interesting thing, because the United States has always been a process as much as a nation. Where does it all lead? I don't like having things rammed down my throat in the name of entertainment. And it turns out most other people don't either. How is Hollywood realizing this? They're having a bunch of movies that don't make back the initial investment. The DC people are pulling movies that are completely filmed and ready to go. And they're not releasing them. Why? Because it's just going to be an epic cluster f- if they do.
Right.
This is, I think, how we learn. If we could work past the bombast and the disingenuous arguments and actually find each other on a level playing field, I'm all for it. Let's actually figure out what we need to do to make things decent for everyone. Equity and inclusion come from regular people. Gay marriage, perfect example. When the straight universe in the United States said, well, why should they play by different rules? Why can't they get married?
Right.
That's when the day was won. It wasn't from people jumping up and down on college campuses. It was from people who watched Will and Grace, where gay characters were just gay characters.
Yep.
It wasn't a particularly gay show. I never thought of it in those terms.
And isn't that interesting? People will watch it. They'll be engaged like that if you're presenting the reality rather than trying to ram a lesson at them.
Yeah. Show me human beings who are not exactly like me, but to whom I can relate.
Right.
And when you get that, the battle is won. I don't ask, is that character gay on TV? It'll emerge if it's a point in the story. It won't if it's not. Kind of like in regular life. To the extent that people focus on story, hats off. To the extent that they require a story to ram home a narrative, I'm just not interested. And I think that's actually a happy note. I predict we will get plenty of hate mail this week, which you can send anytime you want. I delete it as it comes in. Matter of fact, I've set up a rule to delete it as it comes in. Anthony, on the other hand, will respond to every last one of your angry missives. You can also join us on Words and Numbers Backstage, the Facebook group where the conversation continues. You could and should follow us on Twitter because we play around there every now and again during the week. And
check out our new website, wordsandnumbers.org. where you can find all kinds of stuff from our books to our videos to audiobooks to James smoking stories and TikToks, and you can even donate to us.
It's swell how you work in that last thing to keep me from saying what I'm about to say. This website sucks and we need to work on it, but you get the point. We are building this website in no small part because we need now to appeal to sponsors. I mean, the kind that would give five-figure chunks so we can keep this podcast going. So if you are one of those people, you got too much money, you don't know what to do with it, we can help you with that. It's been a while now since Fee has withdrawn its support from the podcast, and we need to replace it. On that happy note, be nice to each other. Have a good week.
See you next week.